Thanks for having me. Well, you know, Levi's right. I am the executive director at the African American Historical Society Museum, but we call it AWESOME for short. That's our Twitter handle. It's a lot easier to say when I'm answering the phone. A little bit about me. I hold a doctorate in history from Indiana University Bloomington campus. I earned that in 2003. I'm a former Fulbright Fellow. I did my fieldwork in the Republic of Mali, and we'll talk a little bit about that today. I'm also a former CIC Fellow, a Committee on Institutional Cooperation, is a consortium of Big Ten schools plus the University of Pennsylvania and the University of Chicago that combine to their resources to help traditionally underrepresented groups earn advanced degrees. And so I was a CIC Fellow at IU for 5 years. That was a wonderful help to me in the pursuit of an advanced degree. And, you know, I've done some other stuff, too, that doesn't necessarily deal with Africa, but I like to think that anthropology, sociocultural anthropology, is a thread running through a lot of my education. I'm also an Asianist in terms of my second field. So I focused on Chinese history as a second field in graduate school. I participated in the East-West Center at the University of Hawaii on the Manoa campus and on Oahu, on the island of Honolulu, excuse me. And I basically was a summer research fellow there. I also was a former Beijing University field seminar participant, so I traveled to China for about a month in 2008, and we traveled to four different sites. So I love Chinese philosophy, and Levi and I were talking about philosophy and its impact in the world. So, you know, that said, I want to talk to you a little bit today about my field work, and I'll tell you a little bit of a story. I love stories. I think most Africanists like stories. They're a fundamental part of how anthropology works. But I'm indebted really to Paula Gershick for even being in this room talking to this particular club at this particular moment. She's an amazing professor at IU Bloomington. And the story is that when I arrived at IU, my advisor told me, get over to the University Graduate School and fill out your paperwork about your major and your minor. And I'm brand new there, and so I don't really know what I want to do, but I'm pretty sure I want to do African studies. And I had applied for a history graduate application. So I go to the graduate program, and you know the registrar says, well, what do you want to do for your major? And I say, I want to do history with a focus on Africa. And she's like, that's great. And then she's like, so your minor's going to be African American studies. And I kind of looked at her, and I said, do I have to? And so she laughed, and she said, no, but what do you want to do? And I said, I want to do Chinese history as a second field. And her response was, we've never had anyone do that. And that made me feel good. Now, of course, China wasn't the roaring powerhouse that it is now politically, economically. It was coming. I couldn't see that because I hadn't gotten into the research yet. But so now, you know, maybe I'm hot stuff. I don't know. That's what people tell me sometimes. I don't know if I believe them because I like to remain humble. So long story short, after I register, I sign up for a sociocultural anthropology class. Somehow, and this was when IU was just beginning to use computers for registration. So I'm dating myself a little bit here. But as that happens, the computers make a mistake. This was a course only for graduate majors, and I was the only person to ever take it, ever. And so the professor doesn't figure out, Professor Gershick, doesn't figure out I'm not supposed to be in this class until 5 weeks are gone, and then it's too late. She's like, stay. We love you. Stay. So I stayed, and it transformed the way I thought about African history. And the reality is anthropologists have been profoundly influential in the trajectory of African studies as fields and as a discipline writ large. And I would not have seen that. I would have caught glimpses of that without this course. And so, you know, long story short, the course changed the way I thought about the world. And it introduced me to a unique figure in African studies, Marcel Griault. Griault was maybe more so an ethnographer than a full-blown anthropologist. There's some debate about this, but emanating from the French School of Ethnography. And Griault did some interesting things in his fieldwork practices that would later raise questions. And if you know much about the history of sociocultural anthropology, you know that it has gone through this unique kind of moment where it reflected upon itself in the mirror, especially during the colonial project. And it raised questions about practices, methodologies, but also fundamental questions about how you gather knowledge about other societies, how you write about it, report on it, etc. And I found Griault to be this interesting figure because I entered graduate school in the early 90s. And Afrocentrism was a powerful philosophy that was sweeping through African American communities during that time. Afrocentrism basically argued that, Western knowledge systems like universities were largely predatory, and they were preying on the representations of Africa's past in ways that were not representative or did not center on the experiences of Africans themselves. And ironically, Afrocentrism had an impact in African history among historians because it kind of forced them to rethink their methodologies for examining the discipline and their various topics. And so I was introduced to Griault because it was purported among Afrocentrists who are largely grassroots intellectuals, not trained in history, not trained in anthropology, right, trained in some other field. They largely drew on his writing to argue that the Dogon, an ethnic group in far eastern Mali on the Bandiagara escarpment, had discovered a star that was not visible to the naked eye. And it was largely based on Griault's writing that these assumptions were made. Since that time, and since the time I entered graduate school, there were serious restudies of Griault's assertions, and most of them were found to not be validatable. And so that raised these certain questions, but Griault proved an interesting figure. In Gershik's course, we ended up reading James Clifford's The Predicament of Culture, which is just an amazing book. The subtitle, 20th Century Ethnography, Literature, and Art, pretty important. And when you look inside here, and I'll just blow this page up a little bit, you see some of the if I can find them here, yeah, some of the titles here. And the chapter that really captivated me was Power and Dialogue in Ethnography, Marcel Griault's Initiation. Clifford writes in this text about Griault. Now, Griault is this interesting figure. He had been a balloon spotter pilot in the First World War. And so what he did when he arrived in the French Sudan, it wasn't Mali yet, when he arrived in the French Sudan, he rented a biplane. And then he went to interview the elders of these Dogon villages. And he asked them, where are your sacred shrines? I want to know. You have to kind of understand this historical moment in the colonial project. Colonial administrators and anyone gathering knowledge on behalf of the colonial project had the power to ask these kinds of questions without really contemplating should they ask them in the first place, or were there better ways to try to work collaboratively with local actors to gather information. And so he asked these questions, and the elders tell him, oh, we have three sacred shrines. And they were the ones that all of the French visitors would get to see. But Griault had actually flown above these villages in his biplane with a camera attached to it, and he'd photographed all the pathways that led to the shrines that the elders weren't talking about. And so then he goes into this unique dialogue in some of his writing about the concept of lying in cross-cultural engagement. And so this idea of power begins to emerge very forcefully in Griault's work. Right, because anytime you label someone a liar, you're making a power claim. And how do you validate that claim? What other forces can you bring to bear to make the truth as you see it come to the fore? Are all of these questions that get raised. And so I absolutely loved this book. But I didn't just read it. Obviously, when you're in grad school and you're in a colloquium, you read like so much. You can't possibly absorb it all. And this was one of the 8 books that we had to read for that week. We managed to absorb as much of it as we could. And, you know, there are some other really amazing names on this list. Of course, you see Malinowski and Conrad there behind me, and Aimé Césaire, important, eminent Senegalese philosopher and thinker. And then you have a few other people here as well, more so a theory, Orientalism. I'm a huge fan of Edward Said's, you know, breakthrough concept of Orientalism, and then the rest of the dialogue that was generated in multiple fields as a result of him theorizing that the West had constructed the East. And so, you know, this is maybe just my beautiful homage to how much anthropology's had an impact on me. And so, you know, Griot ended up writing a few texts. There's one, these are a little small, but Conversations with Ogle Tomele. Ogle Tomele was an elder in Dogon country, and Griot really interrogated him, but he didn't corroborate a lot of what he heard from Ogle Tomele from other sources. And so there are numerous other materials that existed here. James Clifford, in his book Predicament of Culture, describes Griot as someone who would grab an informant by the ankle, shake them upside down until all the change came out of their pockets, right? Right? He's really kind of an aggressive, you know, experience. And I don't know, to some extent, maybe there might be, you know, a kind of reassessment of Griot that may be forthcoming, that takes perhaps more of a middle ground. But he was operating in the late 40s, 1950s in the French Sudan at a time when colonialism was under particular heavy threat. You know, in France in particular, you always want to look at what are the other geopolitical contexts. And in France, you know, there was intense debate about whether colonies should be relinquished. And the Marshall Plan, which the United States had put forward, agreed to rebuild Europe after the devastation of the Second World War. But one requirement of that rebuilding effort and those dollars, I don't know if they were billions or hundreds of millions at that time, but, you know, for those dollars to flow into a formerly war-torn Europe, European countries had to relinquish their colonial possessions. So there's this intense debate about what's going to happen next, and Griot's writing in this period. So it's really fascinating. Fascinating person. So there has been an effort in 1991. There was a critical restudy of the Dogon, and every major claim that Griot made was assessed by Walter Van Beek. And he basically kind of obliterates Griot's essential premises. And this is a part of what was happening in anthropology at this time, right? This is right on the cusp of, if you're a theory head, I like to think I'm a theory head, I love theory, you think about, you know, the changes that happen in African studies. So in the 1950s, you have largely independence narratives that are being written by Africanist historians. But from the 50s to maybe the mid-60s, that maintains itself. But then as African countries decide on forms of government, and they are largely socialist forms of government, the narrative shifts toward Marxism and the neo-Marxism, and that would largely maintain itself in Africanist historiography until about 1985. Between 85 and 90, around the time Van Beek is doing this reassessment of Griot, Africanist historians are beginning to focus on identity studies. And this changes the discipline because the nature of the question shifts. Some of this has to do with who is entering the academy. That's a separate discussion about how the academy functions in terms of, you know, its participants drive the types of inquiries that are asked and posited. So this really fascinating stuff if you're curious. I'm going to get to my lecture in a minute. So this isn't mine. This is just an homage to Anthro. Excuse me. So another book that I read that was deeply influential on me was Jean-Loup Amsel's Mestizo Logics, this book right here. And Mestizo Logics, this book is freaking amazing. And I say that because this book largely focuses on this question of identity in Africa. And one of the things that Griot and many other anthropologists working in an earlier period had difficulty discerning was the impact of the colonial project on their efforts to, you know, harvest information, but also that there are tensions within culture. And so, you know, Amsel is this interesting figure, incredibly well-read. He'd worked in a large number of cultures in West Africa, and he had this kind of, you know, light bulb moment, an epiphany where he realizes, snap, maybe there weren't ethnic groups before the colonial period. Right? And this is profound to make a statement like this when everything that the colonial effort stewarded is centered on ethnicity, being concrete. And for Amsel, because he spoke so many languages, local languages, he starts to see these boundaries are really permeable. And that maybe they weren't set in stone except by the colonial regime when taxes needed to be collected or you needed people to work on a forced labor project or something like that. So this is this amazing history that emerges out of this text. And I was reading this as I started to do my field work. And this is really, you know, where we make a bit of a transition. I don't think, well, Franz Boas, we were at, Levi and I were talking about a little earlier and cultural relativism and the impact of that. And so Amsel really grapples with cultural relativism and cultural particularism in his text, but then moves beyond it to a different, a new frame that I found really compelling. So my field work at this time, I was largely focused on the Mande world. In African studies, there are these sub-disciplines, and they have nicknames. So the Mande speakers are a large family, a language set of language families that basically cover 9 West African nation states. I'll talk about them in a minute. And the scholars who work in this field, they call themselves the Mande Mafia, and mostly because they managed to secure positions lots of places all over the United States and abroad in universities, departments. And they're usually peppered throughout multiple departments that deal with the humanities and social sciences. So they tend to get together and have these mafia engagements. I don't know what that means, but it's kind of, it predates me, but I'm more of a Sopranos guy myself. But so long story short, how do I get to my research? My research began, as most, I think, best research projects begin, on the floor of the stacks at the very back, right? Any person who's done graduate work here knows what I'm talking about. The book that leads you to where you want to be is at the bottom. And it's all the way in the back of the stacks. And you know, I started graduate school when I did, there were no online indexes of books. So you have card catalogs and you know, you write all this stuff out longhand. I don't look like it, but you know, I have great genes, I guess, that's what my mom says. So anyway, I pull this text out in French and I'm looking at a French soldier's account of a jihad that took place in the 1850s. Basically, there were Muslims in Senegal who had made the Hajj to Mecca. And when they come back, well, while they're there, they are radicalized. That's a term we would use today. I don't know if that's more of a journalistic term than an anthropological or historical term, but they come back with a unique sense that Islam is about to collapse and that they need to inject a more rigorous adherence to the precepts of Islam into the faith in West Africa. And so there's a jihad in the Sokoto Caliphate in northern Nigeria around 1801, 1803, and that sets the blueprint for what else happens in the rest of West Africa for the rest of the next 75 years, for instance. And so Muslims realize, hey, we can launch a jihad in order to transform local society and kind of separate what they consider to be blasphemous practice, right? So for them, blasphemous practice meant that Africans were blending their pre-colonial faith traditions and their pre-Islamic faith traditions with Islamic practice. Sometimes in religious studies, this practice is called syncretism. There are lots of different terms for it, right? And so what's interesting is I'm reading this text, and in this text, there's a letter from a Muslim, the leader of this jihad, one that would take place later, from Senegal to into what is present-day Mali. At the time, it was called the French Sudan. And I'll show you. Actually, let me show you right now. So this jihad left, you know, the Senegambia region here, and this is Mali right here. And so the jihad kind of took this direction, and as it did, in each successive city or town, Muslims managed to force conversion of local populations to more rigorous Islamic practice or to introduce the practices in some cases in the way they saw fit. Of course, this is all on the edge of the Sahara, right? So, you know, Muslims have been traversing the Sahara for a very long time. And prior to Muslims, Arabs were traversing the Sahara, and Africans were traversing it in the direction of the Mediterranean too. So it's really not a barrier. It's something that slows people down, but not so much a barrier. And so my narrative begins really in terms of my research when I read a Muslim general sending a letter to the Sultan of Morocco. In this letter, he asks for blacksmiths. And that struck me as very odd, because if you throw a rock in West Africa, you hit an iron worker. So why would this Muslim religious leader and military leader request as far away as Morocco for iron workers? And the bell just went off. Wow, local iron workers are not supporting this conversion effort. So in 1988, kind of leap forward, leap back, one of my thesis advisors wrote The Mande Blacksmiths, Patrick McNaughton. He won the Herskovitz Book Prize for this text that examines iron worker communities and notions of identity. And so this book, you know, I was reading this book, and I had a really profound sense of how complex the relationships were between iron workers and local communities. But here's this jihad leader, and he's struggling to find iron workers. And if you had an army in the, you know, middle of the 19th century, you needed blacksmiths in order to repair your weaponry, but also to arm local farmers with agricultural implements so that they could make sure the army remains fed, et cetera. So this raises lots and lots of questions. And so, you know, it's at this point that I begin to understand the history of this region is connected to the rise of state systems, but it's also connected to the emergence of power associations. So in West Africa, you have unique unions, what we would probably in popular parlance call secret societies. And you essentially move from a membership in a secret society through every phase of your life. So from the age of 7 to the age of 12, for instance, you are in the Chiwara society if you're a young person in the Mande world. Remember, this covers 9 West African nation states. So this is a vast system, a network of franchise branches in every town, village, and city, and even in neighborhoods of larger communities. And so these power associations are unique. Once you exit this Chiwara society, which basically teaches you how to become a young adult, then you move into one where you're initiated into adulthood. And then thereafter, once you have children, you're initiated into another secret society, and you're surrounded by people who have the same experience as you do. And there are rituals and expectations that are required of you as if you are a member in this society. And I'll talk to you about the iron worker secret society in a moment, but really my discovery was centered on, wow, here's a large area with plentiful resources for iron working, but the local Muslims cannot tap into this community. The jihad would eventually die out. In 1861, the leader attacked the city of, well, I'll take that back, 1859, the leader attacked Segu, which is a town, a colonial administrative town on the Niger River where I did a lot of my field work. And then in 1861, he goes on to attack Timbuktu. But Timbuktu is this amazing power in the east, and so they obliterate his army. The leader, El-Hajj Umar, flees to a cave, and they use gunpowder, his own gunpowder, to blow up the cave and seal him inside of it. I mean, just really powerful narratives are a part of this history. And, you know, how did I encounter these narratives? Largely in the National Archives in Mali. Of course, there were some materials at IU. IU has a great African studies library and a great acquisitions program. But, you know, essentially, I ended up having to travel to Senegal and then to Mali to look at these archives. And that was more of a detective's errand than anything else, because you're working with acetate-based paper and it's disintegrating, and these are jigsaw puzzles you're putting together with tweezers on a light board, and it's all written longhand in French. So I couldn't have done that without my research assistant and good friend Omar helping me, you know, navigate some of this. But that's kind of what it takes to put this narrative together. That's a little bit about my discovery. So, you know, obviously we're centered here. I did a lot of my field work in Bamako, where the National Archives is. That's the capital of Mali. And then also in Segu, which is about here on near the bend of the Niger River. And the jihad emerged from this area right here. All right. So a little bit about pre-colonial states in the Western Sudan. I mean, the Western Sudan, that's this area that's pictured right here. This entire area right here, or French Sudan as it was known by the colonial administrators. It was not a stranger to large state-based systems. Of course, in African societies, you have about 75% of the people historically who lived in state-based societies, but 25% lived in acephalous, or what we call headless societies, right? So in acephalous societies, you basically followed a democratic tradition, you voted with your feet. If you didn't like something, you just left. And that's a tradition that probably on some level dates back to the Great Bantu migrations after, you know, a meteorite strikes the earth, tilts the earth's axis. The Sahara, which is this great inland sea, dries out. And as it dries out over about a 2,000-year period, people begin migrating looking for water, and they settle the bottom two-thirds of the African continent, right? So this idea of migrating is not new. That's, I guess, a part of the point. But state-based systems are really, really important in this part of the French Sudan. There's a state called Jenni Jeno, which was a major trading entrepot. There was the state of Ghana, which is not located near where present-day Ghana is. It's located kind of northwest of present-day Mali. And it was situated on the edge of a massive gold field. There are three large gold fields in West Africa, and that drove the imperial period where kingdoms emerge and then rise and fall. And so that history is very interesting. In fact, in the period after the Mali Empire, Muslim travelers write about these massive gold caravans being completely unguarded, because the idea of stealing in this part of the world was really anathema. People, you know, were extremely reticent to do so because it implicated families in ways that caused them to lose face, and it's kind of a bit complicated. The Mali Empire is founded in 1235 by a man named Sunjata Keita. Sunjata was, you know, his nickname is the Lion King. It's a bit ironic. I have an 8-year-old daughter. Whenever she watches the Lion King, you know, she's like, "This is in East Africa, Papa," and I'm like, "No, it's not. You know, it's from somewhere else." But the Lion King's narrative is really interesting, and blacksmiths are implicated in this narrative. So Sunjata, for the first 12 years of his life, doesn't walk. And he is the second son of the king. So his stepbrother, his older stepbrother, is really abusive. He's a bully. And so is the stepbrother's mother. And at one point, Sunjata's mother, who has a physical challenge, she has a humpback, and she walks with a limp. She has this really kind of unfair nickname, the Buffalo Woman. She goes to the queen to ask for some baobab leaves, and the queen insults her by throwing the leaves in her face and making her pick them up. And so she begins to cry, but she's a very tough woman. She's had this kind of rough life, but she begins to cry, and she returns home, and she runs into her son. Sunjata is crawling around on his hands and knees, and his upper body is massive. This is all in the oral traditions, right? And so he basically tells his praise singer, every elite has a praise singer. I have one too. It's called my iPhone with my iTunes library on it. So, but you know, you get the idea. And so he tells his praise singer, go to the local blacksmith's forge and bring the iron bar. So, backstory, right? If you watch, any of you watch Phineas and Ferb, they're always talking about backstory. So, my daughter loves cartoons, so that's where I get that from. The backstory is when Sunjata's father was alive, he actually had an iron bar commissioned by an enclave of iron workers. This bar was so heavy, it took 7 people to carry it. And so he tells these iron workers, they say, "Well, what do you want us to do with it?" He says, "Put it in the corner. You'll know when you need it." So here comes Sunjata's praise singer. You know, he says, "We need 7 men to carry this bar." They carry the bar. They put it at Sunjata's feet. He grabs it, and as he stands up, he forms it into the shape of a bow. No one can lift it. It's this great, amazing allegory about power and the emergence of identity. And so he strings this thing, and everything he aims at on the savannah falls prey to his arrows. And so obviously his older brother is now terrified, because now this child that he's been abusing can walk. And he can't just walk. He's this amazing hunter. So the queen and the stepbrother just determined to send Sunjata into exile. And this is a popular part of Mandé culture. Young people are sent into exile for knowledge-seeking purposes at a certain age. And so they send him into exile, expel him from his father's kingdom. And you know it's going to happen. It's like inevitable, right? It's Star Wars or whatever. He ends up traveling all over the savannah. He builds all these amazing alliances. And then, you know, his mother dies on the way, and that's really the straw that breaks the camel's back. While he's doing that, there's a new power that emerges in the ashes of his father's kingdom, and this is a blacksmith sorcerer king called Sumaoro. Sumaoro is this really cool villain out of African history. Like, if I can ever convince Peter Jackson of The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings trilogy to do an African movie, this is it. Because Sumaoro Kante can transform. He can speak to serpents. He can change into any animal or human shape he wants to, so it's basically impossible to defeat him on the battlefield if you don't have exquisite timing. And so he has this iron fortress that he's built, a giant castle made out of iron, and he manages to capture Sunjata's younger sister, and then he keeps her in a room where he has a giant cast iron pot, and inside of it lives this gigantic boa constrictor. That's his pet. And the pet can discern the future and tell him how his enemies are going to attack. I mean, this thing is ornate, right? You get the idea. Oral tradition in this part of West Africa is serious. It takes 3 days to perform the Sunjata epic in one sitting. And so every night, once night falls, these, you know, performers, these praise singers will perform this narrative. And it's really about inculcating moral values in people, but also teaching them respect for authority and the state, right? There are lots of narratives we could unpack from this. But the Sunjata epic is really, really powerful. And so this blacksmith is centered on this narrative. And there's a bit of an irony here in that, you know, I hate to spoil it for you, but you can go buy the book if you want to. And there are several films that have been made in Mali about this narrative because it's really the national Mandé people's narrative. It's told across these 9 West African nation states by a professional class of rememberers, and they've been doing it since 1235. It's the world's oldest continuously told oral tradition. And so, you know, every year all of the praise singers get together and they rethatch a home in Mali. And they teach the elder praise singers, teach the junior praise singers, here's how you work with this riff, or here's how you improvise in this context. And I know I'm always pressed for time, but I'll get to my stuff in a minute. I love talking about this part. What's fascinating is that this is an improvisational performance. So it has structure. I mean, you have to have structure if you're performing for 3 days for like 6 hours each night, right? But at the same time, the improvisational element comes in terms of recognizing facial features in patrons. So these praise singers can look at a person's face and read, oh, you're Koulibaly. Oh, you're Jata. And when they do that, they slant the telling of the narrative so that Sunjata's lieutenants now become these people from these other families. And they are remunerated with bolts of cloth and gold and, you know, nowadays cars, you know, lavish, lavish gifts. And so the Sunjata epic is really a piece of central cultural value in this part of the world. You also have the Songhai Empire and Karta, which is a smaller empire, and Segu, where I focus most of my research, which is an empire that existed from about 1712, as far as we can tell, to the end of the jihad period in Mali, and then Muslim Segu from, you know, 1861 to 1890. So this area is rich with state traditions. And you can see here, this is Segu under Muslim rule, and it's a really broad area with Timbuktu all the way up in the north, and you can see Lake Debo. These are the areas that, Al-Qaeda fighters and some of Muammar Gaddafi's former guards are occupying in the present, and that the French military went into about this area about a year and a half ago to try to root them out. And so my field work occurred really largely in this area that we're looking at here. So, all right, pre-colonial society in the Mandé world is pretty unique. For a long time, scholars, well, I won't get ahead of myself. Basically, you have 3 classes of individuals. You have Horon, which are freeborn nobles. Usually they were merchants, and they could also be members of the warrior class. The word horon comes from the Arabic word hur, which means free. And so these were believed to be the people possessed of the most power in this part of the Mande world. The second class of people who were believed to have second class citizenship and social status were called Nyamakalau. And I know it's a long word. Nyama means this cosmic energy of action, almost like the force in Star Wars that animates everything. I don't mean to diminish its significance, because local people find this to be incredibly valuable and explanatory. I want to make sure I state that. But you have examples of these casted artisans, and they include, you know, iron workers, griots and bards or praise singers, leather workers, potters. Usually there were relationships, symbiotic relationships between certain groups of casted artisan men and casted artisan women. So potters were almost always women would marry the iron workers, largely because the iron workers in the secret society part of their practice made different types of poisons. They made male poisons and female poisons, and they needed ways to store these effectively so they wouldn't hurt anybody. The potters had all of the incantations that could protect these pots that contained these poisons. And so there are male flutes inside of the secret society that the iron workers have, and female flutes. And they would dispense poisons to people based on a wide number of circumstances. But if you fell outside of the parameters of acceptable practice, you could potentially be poisoned. The male flute never killed, but the female flute did. It was believed to be incredibly pernicious, and these were different types of poisons. And they, of course, had antidotes, but this raises questions about gendered practice inside of these societies, because they were believed to be single-gendered. So the Iron Worker Society was believed for a long time, at least before I did a lot of my research, to be strictly male. We know today that there were women actually in positions of authority inside these societies, which is an interesting proposition. And these societies still exist today. And then you have, as a last group of people, Jong, or enslaved people. Of course, Africans were enslaving each other in the pre-colonial period. At the museum, we have an exhibit that looks at African labor practices before the colonial European contact, I should say. And that's kind of a separate discussion. I'd love to come back and just talk about that, because it's really complex. Now, why were these people in the second group called casted artisans? Because they intermarried, they practiced endogamy. For the most part, scholars believe that was to protect trade secrets. And so long-distance trade was a big part of what people did in this particular group here. And so the social structure is important. Now, this is a photo from one of my interviews. Iron workers, it's kind of ironic. We don't think about iron working often, I find, when I talk to audiences. We think about it in a modern context. And obviously, there are incredibly modern elements to this. And iron working in African societies is incredibly technologically complex. Just to give you a sense of how smelting occurs, you basically need to, and we know this from anthropologists working in East Africa, if iron workers wanted to smelt iron, they would start by constructing a giant clay furnace about the size, the shape of an egg and about from the floor to the ceiling. And inside they would place meteoritic iron that had fallen from the sky, of course. Africa's shape is unique. It's a shallow bowl once you get away from the coast, so it collects iron ore in unique nodes, and you can dry prospect right on the surface. You don't have to sink a shaft mine like you do in other types of iron or metal working in order to find veins of metal. And so because of that, it's pretty easy to prospect. So the general theory is you put these rocks into this furnace, you seal it, you heat it hot enough, the rocks crack open, the liquid iron runs out into a pool at the bottom, and then it can be harvested, it cools off eventually, and then you break pieces off of of it and you use it to make different types of iron-based implements. And so, well, in Africa's case, for a long time, scholars assumed that Africans had developed ironworking technology as a result of loans from the southern Mediterranean. So there was a general belief that, you know, perhaps the Phoenicians or the Greeks and the Romans loaned some of their technology to the Mediterranean and then it filtered across the Sahara. Today we know that's not the case, largely because of morphology. Right? So the structure of African furnaces is unique to the continent. And in particular, one of the things that African ironworkers did, just to demonstrate a bit of this technological capacity that Africans exhibited in the pre-colonial period, they would dig down about 30 feet into a defunct riverbed, and they would find a porcelain-lined clay. They would haul that to the surface, then they would create a mold that looks like a telescope, wide at one end and narrow at the other. They'd pack the clay around it, and they'd create a clay tube. Right, and the tube would allow superheated air to be forced into the furnace. And so they would take and insert the narrow end into the base of this giant clay egg. But the wide end, they would sew a goatskin bag onto the outside of, and then an apprentice would sit on the ground and play these bags. They were bellows. And so as they moved these bellows, they would whistle. And their master blacksmith would walk around the entire smelt. So imagine there's 30 young men sitting around this egg and they're all playing. And they all have different parts. And the master blacksmith would call out the cadence or the title of a different song and the tempo would slow down or speed up and that would up or down regulate the temperature inside the furnace. So when, you know, when kids say, well, did Africans have technology? When they come to the museum, I'm like, of course, let me tell you this amazing story, right? So the technological side of it is pretty unique. Now, what we see here is a photo from my own field work, and I know the term field work has become one that we interrogate, which I think we should. But this is the master smith here. His last name was Traoré. And this is a trench of hot coals. When you are a junior smith, starting about the age of 5, you learn to make charcoal. And you're not allowed to smelt any or smith anything on your own until you make something in secret in the master's forge, and it passes muster. And that might take 20 years. So a lot of these apprentices don't even dream about doing that until they're 20, 25. And so this is the furnace here. This is entirely made of clay. It's kind of like, a mound. And this is a part of a car. It's actually the part of the fan that turns air. And this is a bicycle sprocket, and then these are bands, and you can't see it in this photo, but back here is a bicycle rear wheel, and the apprentices are turning it, sitting on the ground. That's new school. Obviously old school, you would have bellows that you played, and you would force air down through this tube, and then it would get catalyzed by this wheel, and it would superheat and emerge here. You would place the iron. He has a piece, he has tongs that he's made, he has a heavy hammer that he's made, and he would place a piece of iron that he needs to make, you know, malleable into this space until it reaches a certain temperature, and he could tell by looking at the light and the colors on the metal, and then he would extract it and then mold it into what he needed it to be. Now, this is public blacksmithing practice, but in the secret society aspect of ironworking, there's another part of this. And ironworkers can often make ritual objects under unique circumstances. In this part of the Mande world, one of the things I learned from, I interviewed about 300 blacksmiths during the course of my Fulbright fieldwork. And they would tell me that, you know, be careful when you're dealing with smiths, because if they hand you something with their left hand, you know, that's the hand that you use for your personal business. So it's a polluted action. And when that happens, there's sorcery attached to that. And you need to be careful of that. Well, these iron workers, there's a class of iron workers, they carve a mask. I'm going to just go quickly to the end and show you a bit of this. They carve a mask called the Como mask here. And this mask is pretty incredible. When you reach the age of adulthood and it's time for you to be initiated, a horn sounds in Mande towns and villages and even in neighborhoods, and then this mask walks through the village or your area, and the person wearing it is completely covered in straw, so you can't see who this person is. You know, anthropology has been really instructive in helping art historians understand masks are tools of social control. Right, and so this is one way that gets illustrated. And this is a helmet mask, and it's composed of lots of terrifying elements, and it's covered with excrement, also mud, dead animal parts, insects, I mean, the whole nine yards. And there is a notion in the Mande world called DB, which is obscurity. And for the Mande speakers, power is obscure. It's not anything that's going to jump out and just grab you. You won't see it when it's coming. And it's really interesting, these ideas about how power is manipulated. Well, a Mande iron worker will carve this mask. If a mother passes away in childbirth, or then the child and the mother will be buried in an open, in a mound outside of the parameters of the village. And this iron worker will climb atop this mound and carve this thing with his left hand, right? So just to give you a sense of, you know, the power and the secrecy and the knowledge that's embedded in this process. And so, you know, and also that gender makes power happen, right, is really important in the Mande world. There are really three nodes of power. There's male power, female power, and albino power. And they're believed to be secret societies connected to each of these different groups. All right. So this is an iron worker, just to give you an example. This is a praise singer. This was taken from Eugene Mage's text from 1868. He was a military officer who traveled with the French through the French Sudan right after these jihads happened. And so he has tons of amazing illustrations. This is a kora. A praise singer will play this instrument. It's a 21 or 27 stringed instrument. Again, you start practicing when you're five and you learn to play it. You know, you're not allowed to play in front of a full audience by yourself until you're 30. And so these are amazing, musicians. You also see an amulet here, two amulets. I just really briefly, the amulets are important because in the transatlantic period, you would have one amulet that had a part of your umbilical cord in it. But you had a second amulet that had a verse from the Quran wrapped inside of this leather. And in the event that slave raiders captured you, you would pull off the amulet that had the Quran in it and show it to them, because they were not allowed, according to Quranic law, to enslave another Muslim. And so you see these amazing, you know, strategies being deployed by African people to ensure, you know, kind of that they could live a full life in the midst of the Atlantic world. Here's a junior potter. This woman is named Kumba, and she lived in a village where I did a bit of research right next to Segu, and she's working with a wheel here, and she's using different tools that you can see over here to actually manipulate the textures of the pot that she's creating. And she lived with, she was married to an iron worker, which kind of reinforces this cultural value set that you see among the Cassid artisan group in this part of the world. You also have, you know, this is the Segu market. So in the Mande world, there's a rotating market that would happen. There was a 5-day week in the Mande world. So on every Monday, there would be this market that would pull into town. And iron workers sell their wares here. Very colorful place. You can see in the background, there's a mosque, right? I don't know if you can see the minaret right here with the, you know, the crescent. But you see that in the background. And so this was a big part of where I did a lot of my field work. I'm not gonna go through all of Segu's history because it's a lot, but suffice it to say that there are two senior families that are constantly in conflict with each other, the Coulibaly's and the Jaras. They're both blacksmithing families. Now, that proved important for my work because as I conducted interview after interview, I began to realize that these iron workers aren't second-class citizens. I often found villages and towns and neighborhoods where the head blacksmith would go into the home of the village chief and tell the chief, here's what you're going to do. And the chief would do it. And I began to explore, why is it that scholars in my fields have written about this in a way that these are second-class citizens, when in reality they're exerting an awful lot of power in everyday life? And part of the short answer is that in order for your children to become fully realized adults, they needed to be circumcised. And so the iron workers did that. And if the iron workers didn't do that, you didn't have a fully adult son who could participate on a council of elders or et cetera. So this raises these questions about how you transform people from one state into another in their political journey during their life and their life course. And so this is a part of a narrative that emerges here as these two groups really butt heads with each other, and they dominate this town, which is a major trading entrepôt right on the Niger River. And so it raises these questions about whether or not iron workers have second-class positionality or not. My thesis for my doctorate argued no. These people have a broad range of power strategies that they can bring to bear, and they do this, you know, quite often in the course of everyday life and politics. So secrecy. So the Como society is a society with the masks that I showed you. And my fieldwork migrated from just looking at iron workers, because that wasn't necessarily innovative, because Dr. McNaughton had already written about the iron worker communities. He briefly mentioned Como, and I decided to start asking, how old is Como? And did it have a role in the jihad period in the middle of the 19th century? And it turns out that it did. We find that there were different generals that had different masks. They were known by the quality of their mask carvings. They would go into different combats. They would coordinate actions amongst themselves. They recaptured certain towns that the jihadis had captured initially. And so they were deeply invested in the outcome, but they viewed themselves as strictly anti-Muslim during this period, at least in the way that Islam was being defined at that moment. Right, and so this is kind of an important part of the world. The society was run by iron workers. After they blow the horn and the mask walks to come collect these adolescent boys who are headed off for circumcision, initiation first in the bush and maybe in a sacred grove for 6 or 8 weeks, and eventually initiation. If this horn blows and you are a woman or a young child and you see this mask, the mask could exert justice against you. And so, you know, this was, again, a tool for social control. This society I found in my research also used feasts to regulate the economy. They engaged in long-distance trade. They had long-distance trading networks that spanned thousands of miles. And they traded in all kinds of goods. So I also managed to find that beer and honey were important. Men were largely not supposed to ingest honey. If they did, it would emasculate them. But the iron workers kept beehives in the crooks of trees. And the doors or the lids on these beehives, so these hives were covered by straw, like a straw cone, really wide at one end, narrow at the other. The doors were booby-trapped with occult traps. And so, you know, you could really harm yourself if you were a member of the opposition and you attempted to manipulate their ritual objects. And beer was important because, well, we have this great statue at the museum. It's a hunter, and he has an iron axe, and he also has a pot belly. And I point out that in order to become a man in the Mande world, you had to drink beer, right? And so I just tap the pot belly kind of lovingly so the kids get it. But you have the emergence of beer masculinity and this warrior ethos that's pretty important. There's an Italian soldier, an officer who moves through this part of the Western Sudan in 1885, and he writes a lot about this. In fact, his party, according to the claim of the soldier, was attacked by a Como ceremony and all of its participants. They happened by a sacred grove at the moment that rituals were happening, and this unleashed this cultural attack against them, and he writes about it. It's hard to say whether these are veracious or not, whether we can verify, you know, these claims, partly because, you know, at this point in this part of the French Sudan's rule, the French are trying to make a case back in the metropole for why they should rule these far-flung areas. And if you have people who are quote-unquote uncivilized to attack, you know, a European military column, you know, unsuspectingly, then this wasn't just an argument made in Mali or in the French Sudan. It's made in lots of places during the colonial period. So this is a little bit of what emerges in my field work. So I'll just round off by saying that, you know, the best narrative that I encountered wasn't even that. It's this narrative here about a king. There's a king of Segu named Torokoro Mari Jara. And as the jihad is approaching the outskirts of Ségou, he is accused of these violations. He's wearing women's wigs. He's swapping out beer for honey in the royal beer honey pots. And also, he's in the water all the time as a fish, meaning he's constantly going through the ritual cleansing of the body for prayer, right? Five times a day, as happens in Islam. And lastly, that he slept with his brother's wife. His younger brother makes these claims against him, which is basically a set of religious arguments that he's abandoned the faith, the pre-colonial faith system of the Mande speakers that these blacksmiths control. And so the response is a group of uncircumcised boys come to the royal palace and extract this king in the dead of night. They walk him through the main street of town with, you know, people watching on both sides, a throng of onlookers. They take him to a sacred grove and they use a ritual object to kill him. And this is in the written traditions from this period. So this was more than enough for me to start asking really interesting questions of local ironworker communities about this set of traditions. Did these things happen, and what are some of the implications? How did you understand the impacts that they had on the Ségou state? Of course, this unfolds 5 days before the Muslims arrive on the gates of Ségou, so everything turns to chaos because there's no king and there's no way to organize an effective defense, so Ségou falls in about 15 days. And so this is a part of that little thread that I pulled on all the way at the back of the stacks with that book at the floor, you know, where this person's writing about asking for iron workers. This is what came out of that. And I feel really honored that a lot of local people helped me to tell a part of this narrative. And so that's pretty much my talk. But if you have any questions, feel free.
I know we don't have very much time, but I was maybe 1 minute for a really a question about one of the many complex themes that you mentioned, and that is ethnicity. I work in Central Asia, where ethnicity is also a very important concept, and of course Frederick Barth wrote the fundamental kind of go-to work on ethnicity. And so, to some degree, what Barth says about ethnicity rings true for a lot of what I study, even when I look historically back to the pre-Russian, pre-Soviet eras of what people that I study. And so I was just wondering if maybe the fact that, you know, in anthropology, the concept of ethnicity was produced in this particular, emerged out of this particular region in Asia, maybe that's one reason why it doesn't really fit for the African context. Or maybe there are more similarities there.
I mean, that's a great question. I think geographical particularism sometimes has an impact on the applicability of a theory from one place in the world to another place. I mean, we encounter that a lot. And I also think the nature of the colonial experience differed based on whether you were a settler colony or a non-settler colony. And there's lots of variables. So, yeah, I mean, I guess that's my short answer. It's complicated. But I would, yeah, I'm sorry.
I was just going to say some of the things in my own research on ethnic identity. I think one of the wonderful things about Barth's volume is that it kind of pulls apart a lot of the colonial constructs of ethnicity by being kind of this essential part of an identity that's not fluid. And a lot of the Western European powers wanted to treat ethnic, what they perceived of as group identities, as these static things.
Right.
When really they were incredibly fluid.
Right.
But in large part, in many instances, what they were able to document in a variety of chapters in that edited volume was that your identity came from what you do. You are what you do.
And language, too, is really important for, I mean, in responding to both of you, because in the Mande world, the average person spoke 4.5 languages. So, and the idea was that if you could, I hate to use the word imitate, if you could become another linguistic identity, you were that for that moment of time, right? So if you go into the market, and I did this a lot, I'm a Bamana speaker. I can speak Bamana for about 2 hours before people figure out I'm not a native speaker, right? But it took me a long time to get to that point. If the person selling me tomatoes was Jula, I didn't know Jula. But a woman next to me might. She was a Bamana speaker too. She might have considered herself to be a Bamana ethnic member. But she would switch into Jula and get the Jula price for that tomato. And I couldn't do that, right?
It's also about performance.
Right.
Competency.
Yeah, identity as performative. Absolutely. Absolutely. So there are lots of ways to think about it, I think.
Well, thank you, Dr. John.
Well, thanks. It was fun.
Yeah.